I've entitled this sermon today something maybe a little bit weird, but I've called it Mercy Throws a Party. What does mercy do when mercy finds something that's out of place? Well, like the song that you just heard about, mercy comes running. Mercy does not have to be summoned. Mercy is knocking down the door trying to get into your life. That's how much God loves you. The Bible's made it very clear. To become a follower of Jesus Christ is not hard. Now, living for him requires the power of the Holy Spirit helping you. You can't do it on your own. But to come to Christ, here's the beautiful part about it. An old hymn of the church said it this way: just as I am, without one plea, except that your blood was shed for me. That's the way I come to you. Mercy is knocking down the door of your problem, trying to bring you help. God loves you so much. One of my goals in this six-week series is to bring all of us to a place of understanding of the nature of God toward his children, that he loves us, that he is merciful to us. He's not looking to punish us. He disciplines us when we are wrong, but that's because he loves us. Every parent in the room, track with me here. If your child is doing something that will bring destruction into their life, because you love them, you will pull that thing away from them. Let me make it real simple, not even hard. Let's say that this is a personal testimony of experience here. When I was very small, 2 years old or so, I was in the kitchen and I'd open up one of the cabinets, was crawling around in there. And this was back in the day when you had rat poison in the room. And so I had rat poison in the sink there. And I got a hold of it and started eating it. This was before all of the stuff, you know. You remember when we used to have like pesticides that actually killed the pest? You remember that? And we don't do it anymore because now we feel like it's killing us too or whatever. So they've stopped. Well, this was back in that era and in that day. And so they rushed me to the hospital. Again, I'm like 2 years old, 2 and a half or something. And I was not happy at all with the way they treated me. They wrapped me up in a sheet to keep me still and wrapped it so tight that I couldn't move. And then they put a tube down my throat and pumped water in my throat to pump everything out of my stomach. And it was one of the most miserable days of my life. And I was so mad at all of those mean people. And my parents just stood there and watched. I wanted to eat some ice cream. I wanted to have fun. But no, they said, we're going to have to fix your problem. Sometimes when discipline comes to our life, it's not because of God's anger, but it's because of his desire to help us. Understand this, that the nature of God is described throughout the Bible as being a God of mercy, and you ought to just shout and praise God for that, because the Bible says there is no one righteous, no, not even one, and all of your righteous efforts look like filthy, dirty, disgusting, bloody rags that you would not even stoop over to pick up. You wouldn't even pick them up to put them in the trash. You call someone else to come and get it. You kick it away. You don't want anything to do with it. The Bible says that's your best look. Anybody ever had to go somewhere that you want to make a good impression and you go to the closet and you're going to get like your favorite shirt, your favorite dress, your favorite whatever, and you realize it's not there and panic sets in? We look and we go, I don't have anything to wear. There's only 59 shirts and 40 pairs of pants here, but the one I wanted's not here. What am I going to do? The Bible says that our best effort, our best pick, coming to God, looks like a dirty, filthy rag. And that's why we need mercy. God's mercy is declared frequently in the Old Testament and demonstrated in the New Testament by Jesus. It specifically is in the book of Psalms. And I said this a couple of weeks ago. I want to go back to it. Read through the books of Psalms and find the word mercy. It's in there about 100 times approximately. And just read through and find a couple of them every day and let the mercy of God become very ingrained in who you are and in the way you see life. A couple weeks ago, we looked at this question, when do I need mercy most? How many of you remember that sermon a couple of weeks ago? When do I need mercy? We looked at there are three times you need mercy: when you are ashamed, when you've done something that's embarrassing, when you feel like giving up, when you're looking for the hole to crawl into, when that happens, you need mercy. Not only when you're ashamed, but also when you're angry. When life doesn't seem fair. When you feel like, when does my turn come? Anybody ever been in line and you work your way all the way up to the front, and right as you get to the front, they come out and say, we're going to take a break now. And you're thinking, what's up with this? And anger moves into our hearts. How about when you're afraid? Anybody ever been afraid because of a choice you made, because of the way the future looks? Well, the reality is that that thing of being ashamed or being angry or being afraid, they all three come together when we are lost. Anybody in the room ever lose anything that was significant or important? Raise your hand real quick. Anybody ever lose anything? Anybody ever lose something that you never found? Let me see your hand. Oh, God, just give them closure right now. Our family knows well that when we lose something around our house, that if Janet finds out about it, no one will sleep, no one will eat, nothing will happen until that lost object is found. And she's really good. She's really, really good at it. When I was, we'd only been married a couple of years, I was a youth pastor in St. Louis, and we were in this crazy youth game. We had to run, and people threw water balloons at you, and you had to ride a tricycle, and just all this crazy stuff. I'm the guy that put it all together, so I couldn't blame anybody but me. But as I was running, trying to get through the thing, this wedding ring right here that I have on my hand today, this wedding ring flew off out in the field. And I mean, it flew off. It's like, and people are throwing water balloons at me, so I couldn't even stop. I mean, I didn't even realize until later, where's my ring? What happened? I went back and I realized, oh yeah, it came off in there. And so we looked for it, and I mean, it's out in this grass field. And we couldn't find it. We even had, it was kind of getting late, getting dark. We even had cars come around, put their headlights on it. And it was later found by, guess who? Janet McCarty. She can find anything. Anybody in the room ever been personally, not that you lost something, but have you ever been truly lost? I'm not talking, probably not one man will raise your hand right now. I'm not talking about, it's a couple of streets over and I'm fairly close, but anybody ever been in that spot where you just look up and you go, I don't have a clue where I am right now? Anybody ever been there? Let me see hands real high. There's three honest men in the room. That's incredible. You know, when you're lost like that, isn't it true that your emotions get really strong really fast? There's that fear. I may never see anyone I know again ever in the rest of my life. I have no idea where I'm at. And if by chance you're not totally alone, like men, if your spouse is there and they say to you, do you know where you are? Yes, I do. We get ashamed real quick, don't we? I am in my car. I am behind the wheel. I know exactly where I am. I just don't know where this is. And we get angry. Somebody told me this was a shortcut. Anybody ever been on a shortcut? Boy, those are fun. I'm just at that point in my life where I don't want a shortcut. I want like the big roads that get me there. Takes 4 extra hours, that's fine. I want the big road that gets me there. I want to be able to stop and ask anybody. You ever had this thing? We had it one time in a youth group deal. We ran out of gas in the bus. I wasn't driving. A different guy was in charge, and he just totally messed us up. And we are out in the middle of nowhere, Missouri. I mean, it's like near nothing. And we finally kind of come across, and we see a farmer, like out in a field, like probably 2 miles away, flatland. We see him over there. So we go over and see if he's got a can of gas that we can just get something to get the bus going again or whatever. And we pull into this place. I mean, I didn't know these places existed. This was back in the mid to late 80s. It's like a mom and pop store with like all the you know, outside is all dirt. And it's just got the old worn out wooden floors going in. You know, the ones that creak when you walk through and have gaps and stuff. And you know, we're in there. I'm like, well, do you know how to get to wherever? And the guy's like, nope. You know, well, do you know where this is? Nope. And that's when I decided in my mind, I'm going to stay on the big roads. Being lost, though, is not a new concept. Jesus actually told three stories that spoke of this lostness. And even before I go there, look with me at Luke 19:10. I think it's in your notes. It's on the screen. It says, "The Son of Man came to seek and save those who are lost." His purpose in coming was to seek and save. That is mercy coming to the rescue. Then in Titus 3:5 it says, "He saved us not because of the righteous things we have done, but because of His," everybody say the word, "mercy. He washed away our sins, giving us a new birth and new life through the Holy Spirit." Now the three stories that Jesus tells about being lost all come from the book of Luke. Let me tell you about them real quick. Luke chapter 15, verses 1 through 7, and actually the story starts in verse 3. Jesus is, let me read the first part that sets it up. "Tax collectors and other notorious sinners often came to listen to Jesus teach. This made the Pharisees and teachers of religious law complain that he was associating with such sinful people." My, what a thought. "Even eating with them." So Jesus told this story. "Man has 100 sheep and one of them gets lost. What does he do? He will leave the 99 in the wilderness and go search for the one that is lost until he finds it. And when he finds it," here's the title of the sermon, "he will joyfully carry it home on his shoulders. When he arrives, he will call together his friends and neighbors saying, 'Rejoice with me because I found my lost sheep.'" Mercy throws a party. In the same way, there's more joy in heaven over one lost sinner who repents and returns to God than over 99 others who are righteous and haven't strayed away. I'm trying to work the theology of this whole concept out. I've been working on it for about 6 years now, probably. But personally, it is my desire to get saved every day. It's not that I lose it, so don't get all theologically twisted and bent up on me. But the problem that I see is sometimes that religious people forget where they were. They forget that they're saved. And it's because it happened so long ago that it becomes ancient history. You know, when I fill out the cards, it says, "When were you saved?" I put, "Today." "Well, hold on. You've been a pastor for 30-something years." "Yeah, I was saved back then, but I just did it again today. I like getting married every day. I like every day just saying to Janet, 'Hey, still with you. You're still with me. This is fun. This is good.' I like making that commitment fresh and new every day." And here's what I see in my life, my observation. There's some people, they got saved a long, long, long time ago. And they're saved. They love God. But they've lost their joy. And they almost walk in fear all the time that somehow they're missing out. And the sad part is they probably are missing out. Because it's become stale. It's become something that lacks life. And then the devil does a number on us. If you're not a follower of Christ today, the devil, I promise you, will tell you, "Oh, but don't do anything to let anybody know you're not a follower of Christ. You got to keep the image up." Listen to me. If you're not a follower of Jesus and you come and accept him today and you repent of your sins and you confess him to be the Lord, you know what the Bible says will happen at that moment? Heaven goes nuts. And we try to be like heaven down here a little bit. So we're going to get pretty excited too. What does the devil always tell you? "Oh, if you go down front, everybody's going to be looking at you." That's not true. Most people aren't even going to remember who came to the front anyway, unless they have a personal tie, a personal connection. But way, way beyond that, those who are right in their heart and who love God, they're going to know you go down, and they're going to be looking, but they're also going to be celebrating. They're going to be having a party with God, thanking him for salvation that comes from him to us and also to you. All of heaven rejoices when anyone repents and returns to God. Now listen, don't get so filled with pride that you feel like, "Well, if I ever told anybody I'm struggling, that would be, you know, that's tantamount to me acknowledging that I'm human." You are. Now you've got the power of God to sustain you. But the power of God only works when we develop a spirit of humility that realizes it's not in us, it is in Him. This first story is the story of the lost sheep. And when the sheep is found, mercy throws a party. Then Jesus gives another story in verses 8 through 10 there. He talks about a lady who has 10 coins. And she's counting her coins one night, and all of a sudden she realizes that one is missing. It's like it's regular routine. She's got, here are my beautiful silver coin. This is great. Well, wait. There's nine. Where's the other one? She starts looking around. She can't find it. She can't believe she's lost one of her precious silver coins. So what does she do? Does she go into her room and lay down and cry and mourn and mope? No, she starts searching. I think this lady's name was Janet. It's the first Janet in the Bible. She lit a lamp. Notice this. She sweeps the entire house and searches carefully until what? She finds it. And when she finds it, she's calm and collected and says, "Whew, glad I found that." No, when she finds it, she calls her friends and neighbors and says, "Rejoice with me, I have found my lost coin." And you know what they're all thinking? "We didn't even know you lost it. Why are you bothering us in the middle of the night?" How do I know it's the middle of the night? Because she had to light a lamp. And they're all going, "What's the big deal?" And she's like, "I had to tell somebody." You know why? Because mercy ran into her house. Boy, I hope you get this today, and I hope it fires you up all week long. Mercy is running at you. Mercy wants to throw a party in your honor. The last one's the story of the lost son. It's the one we know best of these three. The prodigal son, which is actually more the story of the father than the son. But the son does just some crazy stuff. He thinks he knows everything, so he says, "Give me half my money." In essence, what that phrase right there says, he says to his dad, "I wish you were dead." It's pretty powerful, isn't it? And he says, "Because when you die, I get half of everything you own. But since you're not dead, would you go ahead and give me half of everything you own?" How many fathers got it with me in this room right now? I'd say, I'm going to give you something. But you're not going to like it. The father says, "Okay, I'll give you half what I got." Guy goes out, waste all of it. Pretty short course. Waste every penny of it. And then he comes back home. He's dirty, he's filthy, he has no clothes. He had nice clothes before. He had a lot of provision before. He comes back with nothing in hand. And you know what the Bible says the father was doing as the son's coming back? He's watching for him. And the Bible says when the son was still a far way off, this is a picture of God, by the way, the father. When the son was still a long ways off, the father began to run. And he ran and he grabbed the son and he kissed him and he embraced him. Now, most of us would have probably said, "Hey, you need to go get some new clothes on, take a shower, get cleaned up, see you in 15 minutes. But love says, "I'm going to accept you just as you are." And then the father does something preposterous. This is the kid who wasted half of all that the father owned, wasted all of it. He doesn't do a lecture. He doesn't wag a finger. He says, "Let's throw a party." Older brother comes back and goes, "What are you doing?" And the father says to the older brother, "Look, everything I have is yours. He's already taken his half, so everything that's left, it's all yours now. But do you understand? My son who was dead is now alive again." It's time for the church to be people of mercy that celebrate God's goodness and God's grace. So let me look at mercy with you this morning and talk about being lost and what does that mean. You know, we use these terms in the church world and we don't even always know what they mean. Are you saved? Are you lost? Or, you know, and well, I'm saved from what? I don't know what saved me. I played baseball and they called me safe when I was living in the second, so I guess I am saved. What does saved mean? What does it mean to be lost? Well, let me look at it from Jesus' story here. What does it mean when you are spiritually lost? What do I lose when I'm lost? Well, the first thing you lose, there are five things I want to share with you. The first one is you lose direction in life. When you are spiritually lost, you have no good direction. Isaiah 53:6 says, all of us like sheep have strayed away. We've left God's paths and to follow our own, and the Lord laid on him the sins of us all. The Bible says we are like sheep who have no path, who have no direction. We just wander around. Anybody ever been lost in your car in a city that you don't know, and you're driving a big city, you drive around for a while, and all of a sudden you realize, I think we've already been here. Well, that's irritating, right? Now, men, you know if that happens, you might think it, but you never say it. That would be to acknowledge that you don't know what you're doing. But it's a sad feeling to realize I'm on this trip and I don't even know where I'm going. I am so lost. I don't have a plan. I don't have a path. Thank God for GPS, but they lie sometimes too. Everybody knows that's true. You've all had it happen to you. The Bible says that when we are spiritually lost, we do not have clear direction in our life. It also says that we lose God's protection. We're out there wandering around without him watching over us. Zechariah 10:2 tells a story about the people of Israel. It says, how foolish to ask the idols for anything like that. They're seeking information and direction from idols. And he says, fortune tellers' predictions are all a bunch of silly lies. Can I get a witness on that, even in 2016? What comfort is there in promises that don't come true? Judah and Israel have been led astray and wander like lost sheep. Everyone attacks them, for they have no shepherd to protect them. They have no shepherd to take care of them. When you walk away from God, when you're not walking with him, when you are not under his care, you are out there in a very vulnerable position. You know why it's so vulnerable? Because the devil does have a plan for your life. He comes to steal, kill, and destroy. And in short order, God has a plan for your life. That you would have abundant and eternal life. Life that is filled with joy, that is overflowing, and that will last forever. When we are not found by him, when we are not saved, when we are lost, then we lose his protection. Another thing is I lose my potential. God has a great plan for your future. It's so great we can't even fully comprehend it. We can imagine it a little bit, but we don't know exactly. Anybody ever been somewhere that was just an outstanding place and you knew ahead of time you were going there and you couldn't imagine how good it was, but when you get there, you're really awed by it? I love being around little kids when they go to places that are just extravagant in some capacity. When we used to live in St. Louis, I don't like going up in the arch. Heights don't bother me, but close spaces I'm not real comfortable with. And don't ever do a prank on me where you put me in a tight space because I'll probably freak out. That's just a legitimate storyline right there, okay? But I love watching little kids when they walk up and they look at, or even a little bit older kids, and then they look at the arch. Have you ever stood at the bottom of that and look up? It's just like, it's overwhelming. It's awesome to look up and see that. I think about other trips I've taken, other places I've been, where you go and you look at something and you go, this is incredible. I can't imagine what it would be like, anybody with me on this, to walk into the Oval Office and be there in this room that has housed presidents, or to go over to England to Buckingham Palace. And can you imagine, I've shared this kind of thought before, but you're taking a tour of Buckingham Palace. And all of a sudden, you're not really paying attention. You look up and everybody's gone but you. They've all kind of left you and they weren't paying attention and you weren't. And all of a sudden, you're like, oh my goodness, I'm here. And you're trying to get out. But you open the wrong door and you find yourself in the Queen's residence. Can you imagine just how overwhelming that moment would be? You see, when we recognize the mercy of God, it goes far beyond our description. Here's what the Bible says about the future of every child of God. No eye has seen, no ear has heard, and no mind can even imagine what God has prepared for those who love him. Now, the Spirit reveals it to us, and it's not the Spirit's fault. It's that we have such an inadequate opportunity and ability to translate that. But when we get to heaven and we're with God, it's going to be phenomenal. And if you've got in your mind this idea that heaven is where you just kind of float around on a cloud and play a harp, you are so misinformed. You go, well, Pastor, what are we going to do? I don't have a clue, but it's going to be awesome. You can bank on that. Well, I've got a few ideas. I don't know the whole picture of what it's going to be like, but it's going to be unbelievable. We're going to, well, here's what the Bible says about it. When we get to heaven, even if you suffered a lot for your faith in this world, even those who were persecuted for their faith and were tortured, when they get to heaven, they're going to look back and they're going to say, the things that we suffered aren't even able to be compared to the glory that we now enjoy. In other words, however bad someone suffered persecution and however much they were tortured, when they get to heaven, basically the view is going to be this: that wasn't even a drop in the bucket compared to the glory that I'm receiving now. That's what God has for us. But when you are lost, you lose that. When you're spiritually lost, you lose your happiness. The story of the lost son teaches us that. He goes out, he's got money, he's got everything he needs. But the Bible says in Luke 15:14, about the time his money ran out, a great famine swept over the land and he began to starve. He was lonely. He was miserable. His life was messed up. He thought he knew the way, but the way that he went led to death and destruction, not to life and abundance. We lose our home in heaven. Luke 9:25 says, what do you benefit if you gain the whole world but you lose your own soul? If you personally are lost or destroyed in the transaction, that's a bad choice. I've used this illustration before, but I think it makes it real clear to us. How many of you would be willing to go up in an airplane if you were told this plane will crash and everyone will die, but if you'll take the ride, we'll give you $4 billion? What if they said, we will give you $20 billion, but it's going to crash and die, and then all the money will be lost? Can't even be passed down to your heirs. It's gone. Anybody want to sign up for that? No. What would it gain a man if he gained all the world and all the wealth, but he lost his soul? He lost himself in the process. When we are spiritually lost, we lose the future of being with God forever, and the things that we think will make us happy, we even lose those in the process. Let me ask a second question. So how does mercy save me? Number one, mercy rescues me from myself. You know that most of your problems are self-initiated? Most of the things you got going on in your life that are bad, it's been your choices that made them there. You know, the worst thing in life is when something bad's going on and you realize with that keen awareness and wisdom, I have no one to blame but myself. The reality is that's a lot more common than people realize. Oh, we like to find somebody to blame. It was my third grade teacher. She was so mean to me. It was my mom. It was my dad. It was my brother. It was my sister. You know, it'd be kind of sad to be that dependent upon other people for your direction in life. It's time for every child of God to say, this is on me, and I need to be rescued from myself because I make bad choices. Let me just ask real quick, make sure you're breathing and living out there. How many of you in the room have ever made a bad choice in your life at least one time? Raise your hand real high. Some of you are like, can I get more hands up? Yeah, I've made lots of bad choices. The reality is this: mercy saves us from ourselves. Here's what the Bible says in 1 Timothy 2:5. Christ Jesus is the only one who can bring us to God. Can I get a witness? Jesus was truly human, and he gave himself to rescue all of us. We got to be rescued from ourselves, and Jesus is the one who can do the job. Psalm 50, verse 15 says, then call on me when you are in trouble, and I will rescue, and you will give me glory. Second thing is, mercy not only rescues me from myself, but mercy recovers my potential. It puts me back in the right place where I can experience the blessings of God. I love this. Matthew 11:28 in the Message, Eugene Peterson writes it this way: are you tired, worn out, burned out on religion? Come to me, get away with me, and you'll recover your life. The verse we're more familiar with, or the translation we're more familiar with, says, "Come to me, all you who are weary and heavy burdened, and I will give you rest. I will put you back in a place where you can recover your potential. You can reach your maximum goals in life." Joel 2:25, I love this. The Lord says, "I will give you back what you lost to the swarming locust, the hopping locust, the stripping locust, and the cutting locust." You didn't even know there were that many kind of locusts, did you? They're all bad, too. Anybody ever feel like your life has been hit by the swarm, the hoppers, the cutters? God says, "I will restore it all back to you." And God says, "As a matter of fact, I'm the one who sent this army to destroy you. Because in destroying you, you came back to a place where you realized you needed me." You realize sometimes that problems that happen in your life, God has allowed them to occur so that you would be brought to your senses? When you have a problem in life, let me help you out with this word of understanding. Instead of asking why, ask what. And it's so funny, you know, we ask why questions sometimes when the answer is right in front of us, but we rarely ask the what question. I was at a funeral many, many years ago, and the guy passed away, and he was close to 100. He was up in his upper 90s. And the people around the casket were saying, "Why? Why did he have to die?" And I'm thinking, because he was 97. That's part of life. I don't like it, but it's a reality. You know, I've seen people that are in the hospital and they're on oxygen and their lungs are just diseased and worn out because they've smoked 8 packs of cigarettes every day for the last 95 years. It's a little bit of embellishment there, just to make sure you're listening. And I've seen them, you know, like almost say, you know, take the oxygen off to smoke the cigarette, going, "I don't know why I have lung cancer." A plus B equals, yeah. But what's more, sometimes whys aren't easily answered. But here's what we can ask: what can I learn from this? What can God teach me? More than you know, I wish I had the magic wand to fix people's problems. Sometimes there are things that happen that they hurt. They stink. And I don't always have a good why. But I know this, that mercy will put me in a position to recover my potential. And whatever's been stolen away from me, that if I keep my heart pure and I lean on God, He is a God of restoration. And I'm going to trust in Him. The third thing about mercy is mercy reconnects me to God. 2 Corinthians 5:17, 18, one of my favorite verses. Anyone who belongs to Christ is a new person. I love this. I love it says this, that when you come to Christ, you become a new person, not a better person. Some of you and some of the people that I've met in my life, all they're concerned is getting better at life. And look, you and I both, it's already broken. We don't need to try to improve what we have. We need to become a new person and then improve that. How do we become a new person? Through faith in Jesus Christ. Anyone who is in Christ is a new creation. Isn't that awesome? Some of you, if that just gets into your heart, you'll have freedom today like you've never known. Old things are passed away. Everything becomes new. You're still going to have trials. You're still going to have issues. You're still going to need to grow. But mercy reconnects me to God. Listen to this. God has done it all. He sent Christ to make peace between Himself and us, and He has given us the work of making peace between Himself and others. In other words, this verse says that we are reconciled to God because of what Jesus has done, and the mercy that we receive from Him reconnects me to God. We cannot connect on our own, but Jesus Christ reconnects us with the Father. So how do I connect with God's mercy? Last thing here, three thoughts. Number one, you got to get fed up with your life. You just got to come to the point where you say, I'm tired of this. Think about the parable of the lost son again. Here's what the Bible says about it in Luke 15, 13 through 17. Just some of the phrases there. He wasted it all, had nothing left. He was desperate. He was hungry. He was lonely and miserable. Then finally, it says, he came to his senses. What a great day for all of us to have a fresh awakening to the reality that we need the mercy of God. And those of you that are saints, instead of sitting back with a scorecard watching to see who else is going to do whatever, how about if we got freedom today to realize I need the mercy of God in my life fresh today? Sometimes I hear people, they're not in this church. If you're here, I don't know you, so you can come introduce yourself to me afterwards, I guess. There are some people in some churches, their number one assignment, they believe, is to keep a scorecard and criticize everything going on. And the one that always gets me is this, when people say, well, I don't like our church because we just don't see God move like I want to see him move. And I want to think, well, that's strange because you're here, right? Can I get a witness? They act like it's everybody but them. You know the way to fix that and to see God accomplish his will is for all of us who are followers of Jesus Christ to come into the building with the spirit of God. I want to be an initiator of your grace today. I want to be a full recipient today. I'm not going to sit back as a spectator. I'm not going to sit back as a commentator or an analyst, but I'm going to get right in the middle of what you're doing. You know what would be so cool? If we all got so plugged into what God was doing that we really didn't know a whole lot about what happened to anyone else. But we knew what he had done for us. That's good preaching, whether you like it or not. See, when I connect with God, I get fed up with my life. I realize that I got to come to my senses. Jeremiah 29:13, when you come looking for me, you'll find me. Yes, when you get serious about finding me and want it more than anything else. Now, there's a dual side of this in Scripture. The one side is God is searching for us, but the reality is, in God coming to us, we will never find him until we begin to search back. There's our taking our part, but here's the awesome thing. When we start searching for God sincerely, anybody in the room ever play hide and seek with a 2-year-old or 3-year-old? If you haven't, let me give you a couple of clues to help you out here. When you're playing hide and go seek with a 3-year-old, you really don't hide. You move from the couch to the chair. That's considered hiding right there. And when they start looking for you, they go to where you were before and you're not there. And you just kind of sit over there like you're trying to hide. And then they go, ha! I found you. And they laugh and they have fun and they go, let's play again. Now with the 3-year-old, if you go hide in the closet, you will be in the closet 4 weeks from now. Because they don't have the capacity to figure out. They're probably in the closet. If you're playing, here's rule number one. Playing hide and go seek with anybody under 4, you hide in the open. And just try to act like you're hiding and it works. When God says, look for me with your whole heart, you know what he's saying? I'm right here. He's not hidden in the sense of that he's difficult to find or hard to get near, but when we recognize he's right there and we just reach out to him, mercy will come running after you and throw a party in your honor. Not only do we have to get fed up with our life, but we got to own up to my sins. Luke 15, 7, 18, the story of the lost son again. When he finally came to his senses, he said to himself, at home, even the hired servants have food enough to spare, and here I am dying of hunger. I will go to my father and say, Father, I've sinned against both heaven and you. He said, I'm going to go back and say, this is my fault, this is my problem, and I need your help. Just remind you today that you can't fake God out. If you try to show up and like, well, I want to put on my best clothes and I want to act like I got my life all together, and maybe he won't realize Bible says he's able to see deep into your soul. And he knows everything. He knows things about you that you don't even know. So when I come to God, I got to be transparent. I got to say, God, I yelled too much at the football game the other night. And help me, Lord, to be the person you want me to be. Too often, what do we try to do when we come to God? We try to do a sales job. We try to justify, God, there aren't many as good as me out there. God, I'm going to get up early and pray every day. God, I'm going to do this and I'm going to do that. And the Bible says, all of your righteous activities are like filthy rags. You know what we have to do when we come to God? We have to come to God and say, God, I don't have anything to offer you. I don't have any bragging points, but you are awesome. And I think together we could do some good stuff. I'm reminded of a story of one of the Chicago Bulls several years ago. They were playing a game, and they had won the game by 2 points. And this is Michael Jordan's heyday when this story happened. He had scored like over 50 points that night. So all the reporters and the beat writers were all in there surrounding Michael Jordan. Hey, you scored, 58 points tonight or whatever the number was. How did it feel? And they're all talking to him. And one guy comes in late. And I mean, there's such a throng around Michael Jordan, he can't even get near him. So he goes over to one of the other guys that was actually a bench player, didn't play very much. But that night, he had scored 3 points. And he thinks, well, I'm going to just go ask this guy, what was it like to be on the court with Michael Jordan tonight when he, had his greatest game ever, scored more points than he'd ever scored before? What was it like being out there and watching the game? And the guy says, well, me and Michael had a great game tonight. Yeah. And he said, Michael scored a bunch of points, but without my three, we would have lost. This is not an arrogant thought right now, but it's recognizing how awesome God is. We have the privilege of coming to him and saying, God, I'm nothing. Don't have talent, don't have ability, don't have wisdom. I have to ask you for it every day because I just can't make it on my own. But God, you are awesome. And there's no limitation to what you can do. And I think between me and you working together, we can pull off some good stuff. Having faith in God. When we come to him, we own up to our weakness. But the last one, and I just alluded to it there, is we offer up ourselves to God. In Luke 15, it says, he returned home to his father. And while he was a long way off, his father saw him coming. Filled with love and compassion, he ran to his son, embraced him, and kissed him. Romans 5:2 says this, we throw open our doors to God and discover that at the same moment, he has already thrown open his door to us. We find ourselves standing where we always hoped we might stand, out of the wide open spaces of God's grace and glory, standing tall and shouting our praise. Isn't that awesome? 2 Corinthians 6:2 says this, God says, at the right time I heard your prayers. On the day of salvation I helped you. I love this, the New Century Version. I love the way they translate this. I tell you that the right time is now. And the day of salvation is now. The last verse speaks to all of us who are followers of Christ. Therefore, I urge you, brothers, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as living sacrifices. That's why it's important what you do with your body or what you don't do with your body. Holy and pleasing to God. This is your spiritual act of worship. Do not conform any longer to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then you will be able to test and approve what God's will is, his good, pleasing, and perfect will. I hope that everyone in the room today gets a fresh dose of the party that mercy will throw in your honor. I'm pretty sure that every Sunday, almost all of us just need that time of refreshing. There are some here today, it may be that for the first time, you're going to change direction in life. You're going to put your faith in Jesus Christ. You might be 12, or you might be 30, or you might be 90. I don't know. It doesn't matter how old you are, male, female, whatever your race is. None of those things matter. You know what matters? That all of us need to find that grace that comes through putting our faith in Jesus Christ. When you cry out to Jesus, He's quick to answer. I think we have to be careful not to think there's a pattern or way to do things. And even in this moment right now, let me give you a little bit of insight. I probably wrestle more every week on how to do this than all the rest of the stuff. I can dissect scripture and give you stories and do whatever, but trying to figure out how to lead what God wants to do right now is always a challenge. And I actually need some partners. Wasn't going to go there, but I'm going to go this way now. Kind of an interesting thought here. I need some people who will help me in this moment with your prayers, with your participation. The greatest thing that can happen right now is for each person in this room to experience God's mercy fresh in your life today. Whether you're far away from God or whether you woke up this morning singing His praises, we need God's mercy every moment of every day. The worst thing that we can do is just kind of sit back as a spectator and say, well, that was okay today. Or even say, I enjoyed it. That was good today. It's not a matter of how your critique falls. It's a matter of that activity of being a spectator and an analyst. What we have to have in the house of God are participants who open their heart and say, oh, God, that's what I need in my life. Oh, God, that's what I want.